Jinnah was the creator of a state which never existed on the map of the world. And this is something very unique, because there is hardly any example where a person could achieve a new country.
He was an amazing, he was a colossus, really. I don't think there was one leader who inspired so much awe, respect and affection at the same time. There was such total faith in his honesty, integrity, his intention, and exactly that he meant whatever he said.
I knew then, of course, which we know now, that it'd be impossible to replace. But he left a tremendous void. He has risen. He has risen above the normal position occupied by a great leader, and he has gone into the Valhalla. He virtually belongs to the pantheon, as it were, of a transcendental personality who is above reproach. I think he merits it to the extent that mortals do. He was obviously cast in that extraordinary mold of classical greatness.
The people, of course, had many hopes in Jinnah, because he was the only leader which the Muslims had produced for a very long time who could deliver the goods. It was only this so-called westernized Muslim who somehow or the other led to some positive results, gave them a state. That is why there was such disillusionment on his death, because the Muslims didn't know what to do. And it was with that spirit that the moment they learned that he has died, there was a flock and rush towards the governor's house where his body was lying. I remember, because it was lying in the courtyard outside the governor's house.
And I remember there was sort of a very eerie silence all around. Nobody was really weeping and wailing at that time. And there was just a stunned silence, because I think most people didn't expect to think that he was about to die, that he was as ill as he was.
There was a sea of humanity sobbing and wailing. You could hear distant echoes of the sobbing and wailing. And then lowering of his body in the grave, firing of the volley, the last post. Miss Jinnah and Dina Wadia, the daughter, coming up to the grave and looking down. It was a very, very trying moment.
Oh, it was massive. I've never heard so many people, I mean, the mourning and crying and thousands, lakhs. That was to be expected. That's very Indian, very Pakistani, both. But anywhere, somebody like that. Remember that Pakistan had only been going for a year and something, so it was very emotional.
Successful Indian barristers like Jinnah could still be the objects of patronizing or racist British attitudes.
He could stand up to any judge. And in the early days, I regret to say that some of the British judges used to behave in a little odd fashion with the Indian lawyers. He was very critical, in fact, more critical than many of the Congress leaders, because he was opposed to colonial rule, the British domination in India. From the beginning, he was demanding self-rule, and then he demanded independence not only for the Hindus, but for Muslims as well.
When Jinnah entered politics, it was as a liberal nationalist, like his old hero, Nauroji. The grand old man was presiding over the 1906 session of the Indian National Congress, now calling for self-government. Jinnah was an enthusiastic recruit. Later, the same year, the Muslim League was formed by a group of wealthy Muslims, including the Aga Khan, Sir Sultan Muhammad Shah, who served as the League's president from 1907 to 1912. Concerned to safeguard the rights and interests of Muslims, the League devoted its early efforts to their recognition and protection as a distinct community within the existing framework of British rule. Such loyalism made no appeal to Jinnah, who refused to join until the League embraced the nationalist aims of Congress.
If you read what Jinnah said and did right from 1906, when he really entered active politics, you cannot find a better explanation of the Hindus and Muslims coming together, emphasizing the commonality between them.
In 1915, when Mohandas Gandhi returned from South Africa, Jinnah gave a garden party. Thanking his host, Gandhi publicly singled him out as a Mohammedan. The tactless description set an uneasy tone for a relationship which would have profound consequences for the subcontinent. Jinnah resented being typecast as Muslim when his manner and dress were so westernized and modern.
When Gandhi came from South Africa, my father was already an established politician.
What would they have had in common which would have led them to understand each other?
Well, I think the original thing that was in common was how to get the British out. How to get India independent.
Jinnah came to be known as the ambassador for Hindu-Muslim unity, following the 1916 Lucknow Pact between Congress and the League. This was the culmination of his efforts to achieve a united front. And though the pact would never be implemented, it marked the peak of Jinnah's career as an Indian nationalist. He was now a star of Bombay's high society.
Bombay was the first city of India, and there was a very sophisticated Indian bourgeoisie. It flowered in a way it flowered in no other city around the first quarter of the present century. Now, Jinnah belonged to that world, and he was a very cosmopolitan and extremely sophisticated and cultivated member of this particular class. He moved in these particular circles. He belonged to this circle through the success he had earned for himself at the bar. He was one of the most distinguished members of the Indian bar.
Most of Jinnah's close friends belonged to Bombay's prosperous Parsi community. He used to dine at the elegant Bombay residence of Sir Dinshaw Pettit. He met Sir Dinshaw's daughter Rutty, who was less than half his age. For the only time in his life, Jinnah fell in love.
She was young, beautiful. Very, very intelligent, very bright. Loved beautiful things. And she was a very humorous, fun person. They had the same sort of interests in the way of politics and things like that. And he was already a pinnacle in a way. So that was very glamorous. They fell in love. And my grandfather was absolutely appalled, first of all, because of the age difference. I think he was 39, and she was 16. And she came from a prominent Parsi family. And he wasn't too anxious that he should marry out of her community. My father was a Muslim. Distinguished or not, didn't seem to matter. The moment she was 18, that was it. She walked out and married him.
Rati converted to Islam before the wedding ceremony at Jinnah's home in Bombay. None of her relatives attended. The couple went to Delhi for a brief honeymoon at Maidens, Jinnah's favorite hotel. Rutty's charm and flamboyance became legendary.
We had heard that she was very beautiful, and we were all very excited to wanted to see her. She was very beautiful. But she upset my grandmother because she wore a sleeveless blouse and her middle was could be seen. My grandmother resented it. She sent for a dushala. You know what a dushala is? A dushala is that embroidered with gold thread, very heavy. So very diplomatically, my grandmother said, dushala lao bua. She covered her up. She said, Bibi, you're a Muslim now. You can't go about naked. So this upset Rati. She complained to her husband. Mr. Jinnah complained to my father that she has insulted my wife. Then Mr. Jinnah never came back while my grandmother was alive.
Jinnah's uncompromising nature was about to drive him into the margins of politics. The First World War over, nationalists and Congress were now demanding immediate self-government for India. In 1920, this provoked a split with Gandhi. Like Jinnah, Gandhi had trained in London as a barrister. But he'd discarded his lawyer's suit for simple peasant's clothes, and he turned the elitist independence movement into a campaign of mass civil disobedience against the British. Such unconstitutional action was to Jinnah an anathema.
He was, in the very precise European sense, at that juncture, a very secular person. His politics was liberal, his politics was secular. These were the two planks he was pursuing. These were the planks on which his militant nationalism rested. And Gandhi's appeal to religion as the basis of drawing people into politics, particularly as far as the communities of Islam was concerned, because he reached out to the pan-Islamic sentiment of the 20s, Gandhi did. And Jinnah was very unhappy about this.
He gave the answer himself in the speech. He said it will not succeed. You will yourself will have to recall the movement which you are launching without proper preparation. You don't know the masses. They will not be able to adhere to the program which you have indicated before them. So first prepare the nation for that. Prepare the people and then embark on any program that you want to launch.
Isolated, Jinnah left Congress. After his final speech, rejecting Gandhi's new tactics, he was booed off stage.
I think that was a great step, and that was, according to me, the first step towards Pakistan.
The loneliness Jinnah experienced in his political life was intensified by the breakdown of his marriage. Rati, increasingly estranged from her husband, sought refuge in mysticism and spirit communication. Eventually, she left Jinnah and moved into Bombay's Taj Hotel.
It had begun with love, but his own stiffness and incapacity for becoming human and relaxed didn't permit him to have the kind of relationship which a lover would have. Husband, certainly, but a British husband, if you like.
Well, what happened is that he was a very, very busy man. He had all his cases, I mean, he had a living to make. And then he had politics. And you know, a young, beautiful girl, maybe he wasn't able to give her the time that she should have had.
He didn't confide, but she did confide. I knew at that time, separation was inevitable. How could two people carry on life to distance from each other? He in the law court all day, and coming back home, even then going to study. And I felt altogether that he couldn't have been happy with a Orthodox Muslim wife in Parda. He could not have been happy with an English woman. He thought this compromise would work because she might become a Muslim wife, but she didn't.
Then she fell ill. She fell very ill. And that was very difficult. She died of colitis. But very bad colitis. I believe there are several types of whatever, and I think she had one of the worst. She really was very, very, very sick. They used to visit her when she was so ill, in any case.
And that is the first time when people saw him with tears when he came from Delhi to attend the funeral. And he was a man without any emotions otherwise. It seems it had a great void in his life. He never remarried thereafter. But I knew that he had preserved all the clothes, the photos, and the books of Rati in a very special room. And at the same time, he had kept the proceedings which took place in court, the marriage papers, they were intact.
But I think that he withdrew a lot, you know, not in his work, not in his politics, but I think that he became even more dedicated to his work.
Jinnah decided to leave India. He set sail for England, where he would live for the next 5 years with his sister and daughter. Nothing could have seemed more improbable than that in just a few years, Jinnah would found a nation. Eid Day at the Budshai Mosque in Lahore. Celebrating the end of their annual fast, tens of thousands of Pakistani Muslims gather together. A Muslim political identity was for many the consequence of the religious and cultural differences they experienced living alongside Hindus and Sikhs.
There was a very superficial mixing of the two communities. There was no real intimate friendship. There was a certain amount of wining and dining in each other's homes in the upper class. We had a few Muslim boys at school, but there was not as much coming and going with them as they were between Hindus and Sikhs, where there was no difference at all. Well, the Hindus wouldn't have Muslims in their homes to eat. They had separate dishes for them. If they did ever get a Muslim, they'd get different crockery for them. It had been brought up in me that, you know, for one, the stereotype of the Muslim, you know, that they are unclean, they're not careful of their hygiene, etc., the same as Muslims had about us. So that kind of thing kept a distance between us.
The awareness of difference motivated the 19th century reformer, Sir Syed Ahmed Khan, to found a new university at Aligarh. The Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College had the aim of getting more Muslims into government service and the professions. And Sir Syed, concerned that many Muslims were educationally backward compared with Hindus, went on to argue that the two communities, in fact, formed two different nations. In other words, that their religious identities overrode all other distinctions of class, caste, language, or region.
Sir Sayyid was the first to raise this issue of two nations, I would say, when he pointed out that if the Westminster type of democracy is introduced in the Indian subcontinent, the result of it would be that the majority would keep the minority, Muslim minority, in its hegemony. So therefore, there must be some system which should safeguard the rights of the Muslims. All those who were followers of this viewpoint, they somehow or the other felt that there could not be any genuine understanding between the Hindus and the Muslims. And eventually you can say that it resulted in the secession of Islam from India. But then it was a kind of an idealism which had developed in due course of time from Sir Sayyid onwards. My father subscribed to this viewpoint.
Today, the poet Muhammad Iqbal is hailed as one of the intellectual founders of Pakistan, a status symbolized by the position of his mausoleum next to Lahore's Badshah Mosque. Iqbal took Sir Sayyid's ideas a stage further, calling for a self-governing state for Muslims, though still within a united India.
Iqbal says that Islamic State in modern times must be based on three principles: human solidarity, human equality, human freedom. He says the ultimate object of Islam is to establish a spiritual democracy. He is the first person to use this expression, spiritual democracy, while explaining what is an Islamic, modern Islamic state. If you were to come across Jinnah, he also says that the state in Islam, the state in Pakistan, will be based on Islamic principles.
It is my belief that our salvation lies in following the golden rules of conduct set for us by our great lawgiver, the Prophet of Islam. Let us lay the foundation of our democracy on the basis of truly Islamic ideals and principles.